Okay, excuse me. Can we start with a roll call?
Certainly. Mr. Williams.
Present.
Ms. Lingalis.
Here.
Ms. Jordan Byron.
Present.
Mr. Mushak.
Here.
And Mr. Shulman.
Here.
Yep, go quorum.
Okay. The first item on our agenda, the preliminary review, excuse me, of 41 Wolfpit has been withdrawn. So we're going to go right to review and action on applications. And we have before us 2022-54, 8-24. This is a referral. It's Department of Public Works. It's a request for the City of Norwalk to revise their easement agreements with Eversource regarding underground electrical lines for purposes of the Walk Bridge project. Who is representing the city on this?
Attorney Callahan is here. Vanessa Valadares from DPW could not be here tonight. She had to be at a different meeting. So I think it's pretty straightforward from what you saw in the packet. The initial proposal was approved by the former planning commission. Previously, the route has had to change a little bit. They're rerouting through the park. I'm happy to pull the plan up so the commission could see the changes. I think those were provided to you already, the different routes.
Why don't you do that? And let's have a very brief overview. Excuse me, on the details.
Sure. Let me just get down to the maps. I think the color images are probably a little easier to see.
Right.
I think I'm upside down.
There you go. Can you scroll that up just a bit, Steve?
Yes.
That's perfect.
Okay.
So all right. Go ahead.
So I believe this shows the rerouted proposal from what was initially submitted. By and large, there's not significant changes to what you saw before. The intent is overall is to take the utilities underground from behind the police station down Elizabeth Street crossing, which I believe now is a vacant parcel, under the Norwalk River, popping up again on the other side and crossing through Vets Park, but they had to do some rerouting. The intent is, you know, the alternate is to have, you know, obvious large overhead infrastructure, which is a significant detraction from the streetscape and everything else going on with the improvements in South Norwalk. So this is, you know, a much better alternative in terms of aesthetics, which the city would like to see happen.
What's the likelihood that in the near future, let's say, repairs or further changes need to be made? Or is that something that's not likely to happen?
Once the wires are buried and installed?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think the intent is for them to be there and not to need to be touched. You know, really hard to speculate if there was an incident where they had to get at them. You know, I suppose it's always possible.
So, Steve, my understanding, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
So my understanding is that, you know, generally speaking, these things, once they're installed, are you know, there for quite a few decades. I can't remember exactly what they said, but, you know, I remember it being like 40, 50 plus years before they need to be replaced, maybe even longer. It was a substantial amount of time. I mean, there's a possibility, there will be a vault. The vault will be on 136 from memory. You know, they may need to access the vault, from time to time. There could be issue where they have to do a repair. I mean, that's always a possibility with any underground wires or any overhead wires as a result of a storm or something like that. But what we've been told by Eversource is, for the most part, that there shouldn't be a high degree of disruption once the project is completed.
All right. Are there questions from the other commissioners?
Lou?
Yeah, go ahead, Tammy.
More of an observation and a concern. I see the red solid line going up toward Van Zandt Street, and then I see the dotted line going across the front of the park on Seaview Avenue. My concern is there are a lot of really nice trees along that strip by the sidewalk there, and there's a nice stone wall. Does anybody know what they're digging up?
I don't know off the top of my head. It's my understanding that nothing from that perspective has changed from what was initially approved. That red line there is where they're going to pull the line from.
The dotted or the solid line? Sorry.
The dotted line. That's okay. Where they're going to pull the wire into the underground. So it's just a staging area. No, I don't. We have received nothing that indicates that any clearing that they would need to do would be materially changed from what was the case when this initially came through.
Oh, and do you recall if on the initial proposal was it to cut down all the trees along Seaview Avenue like they've done in so many other places in the city this past summer?
I do not know what the plan is for that off the top of my head. This went through, it was quite a while ago. I think they were initially identified on the plans where they would need to cut them down. I couldn't tell you specifically.
Okay, it's a very large concern of mine. And I know that Eversource was granted a certain amount of free rein to cut down a lot of trees in the city, and they really have. It was extremely noticeable this summer. And we're supposed to preach, and we make every applicant that comes before us plant new trees. And Eversource is taking down way more than their fair share. So I don't know if that's something that can be rectified or not, but I just want it out there that I think they've decimated a lot of nice trees in the city of Norwalk.
Tammy, on the map, I had to put my glasses on so I could actually.
Yeah, I kind of can see some of those little dots, Steve, too. And it's a little hard.
Let me show you the legend at the bottom, which might.
Okay.
You see this right here, proposed vegetation removal,
mm-hmm. Yep.
Trees to remain.
Yep.
So vegetation removal is indicated kind of at the corner of Seaview and 136. Mm-hmm. And then trees to remain, I think, is shown in a couple other spots. Let me just. Box,
yeah.
Off to this corner over here. So it doesn't show anything. It's hard to tell because this is an aerial photo with just the lines overlay, but I think the trees mm-hmm. are on the Seaview side of what the dotted line through here.
Yes, I believe they're on the sidewalk by the stone wall. And there is a map of, a mechanical map, survey type map in one of the other slides that you gave us. It's a little hard to make out. And that proposed construction area looks to me like it goes over there. So I'm sure I'm not going to win the battle, but I really want the city to take note, if Eversource is decimating all the beautiful trees along there, that they be replanted.
Okay. And we can definitely pass that on to, I know there are, aside from this project, there are streetscape improvement plans, and it was actually in the East Norwalk TOD plan was to do improvements along that section of Seaview Avenue. So I definitely think additional trees and or replacement trees, if that ever came to pass, would be part of that project.
Well, Steve, is Eversource exempt from the requirement we would put on a private contractor that if they take down trees, they have to replace them in kind?
You know, I don't know. This is because this is really it's a city project as well as it's a project for, you know, the state as well.
Mm-hmm.
Keeping in mind you're burying underground utilities, so we have to be careful of where you're saying you're going to require trees to go back in the future. So we just need to keep that in mind. I think it's pretty easy for us to pass along the message to DPW that if there is any trees to be taken down and there's the ability to safely reinstall or add trees to that area, that's something that the city would like to see happen.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. If not, Steve, this is a simple vote to approve this change.
Yeah, I think there we go.
Yeah, okay.
This is part of the resolution language that was passed along.
Right.
So this is an 824 review and report.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you're just making a finding of consistency with the plan of conservation and development.
Right. Right. Can I have a motion to that effect?
I'll make the motion.
Okay. Darius has made the motion. Is there a second?
Mike, second.
Okay. Mike, second. Any further discussion? All right. If not, I think we can do this with a show of hands. All those in favor of the motion? Okay. Looks like it's unanimous. All right. Let's move on. Thank you, Attorney Callahan.
Oh, thank you.
Next item, 2022-45SP, 8-10 Pulaski Street, modification of application 16-97SP to add an additional dwelling unit to existing 15-unit development for a total of 16 units on site. Report and recommend action. And who is here representing the owner?
Chair, Commissioners, Chris Russo with Russo and Rizzio LLC, office at 10 Sasco Hill Road in Fairfield. Here on behalf of the applicant, we had actually before, prior to the hearing, we had sent in a request for continuance. So we'd respectfully request a continuance. There was some comments made, one particularly from DPW asking for some calculations on our water usage with an additional dwelling unit. So my client's in the process of getting that information to the engineer so they can then provide it to DPW. So we'd like to request a continuance for additional time to get that to DPW and make sure they're okay with it.
Okay, Steve, do we have any time constraints on this?
No, we do not.
Oh, thank you, Michelle. Okay. Can we push this to the next meeting?
Maybe. We'll look at the calendar.
Okay. Then Mr. Russo will have you work it out with the staff as to when it goes comes back on the calendar.
Great. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Okay. We're now going to hold our three public hearings. The first, 2022-35, SUBD/CAM, 22 Lounge Avenue, LLC, two-lot subdivision with proposed private alley. Let me explain to members of the public how our public hearings are conducted. The applicant will have an opportunity to discuss their project in detail. During that discussion, the members of the commission are free to ask whatever questions they like. When the presentation is completed, we will open it up to public comment. We ask a couple of things. Number one, that you identify yourself and provide us with your address. And we ask that you simply remain civil in your comments. We also ask that you make sure to ask any questions that you have, but we also ask that you do it in as expeditious a way as possible in order to give everyone an opportunity to provide comments. And I'll remind you, this really is not a conversation you'll be having with the commission members. It is actually more comments directed to the property owner or developer. When all of public comments have been heard, we turn it back to the developer or developer's representative for comment on the comments that have been made. And again, during that time, the commission members will have an opportunity to raise any questions they have. We then will close the public hearing and move on to action on the application. When we get to the public comment, we will ask, I think, Michelle to explain exactly how you access this site in order to provide your comments. With that, Mr. Russo, are you going to be representing?
Yes.
Okay. Then I'll turn the floor over to you.
Thank you, Chair, Commissioners. Good to be back again. Before you, on behalf of the applicant, Chris Russo, with Russo and Rizzio LLC, offices at 10 Sasco Hill Road in Fairfield, Connecticut, for the property at 22 Lowndes Avenue for a two-lot subdivision. First, let me say I want to thank the commission for being patient in allowing us time to review this application. And I think I've read the regulations about 100 times now, rereading the same lines over and over again. But I know this has been on your agenda for a number of times, so I appreciate the commission's patience on that. So this is a application just for a subdivision, and I want to be clear on that because there are some comments that I'll get to later where it would seem to be indicated that we are applying for dwellings on these lots as well, but we are not. We are just applying right now for the two-lot subdivision. If a dwelling was to be constructed on these lots, if this application were to be approved, we would have to come back to you with that dwelling, with those dwellings for coastal site plan review. So what's before you tonight is just the two-lot subdivision. So if I could share my screen, I'll go through the site. Okay, hopefully that popped up on the screen there. Okay, yeah, I think it's. So this is a site, 22 Lowndes Avenue. It is located in the Residence C zone. As you can see here, there was a survey of the property. There's a single family dwelling that's non-conforming. It's non-conforming as to setbacks from the street. Located right here, but then also in another single family dwelling that is obviously also non-conforming due to the fact that it's located directly on the rear property line. But this is another single family dwelling. So two single family dwellings on this property located at the very end of Lowndes Avenue. These structures are proposed to be demolished. The site in its entirety contains almost 22,000 square feet, which is more than four times greater than the lot area requirement in the residency zone. It completely dwarfs other properties on Lowndes Avenue and nearby streets, most of which contain between 5,000 and 6,500 square feet. And even after, and when I'll show you this when we get to the subdivision plan, but even after the proposed lot split into the two separate lots, one lot would be a little over 9,000 square feet, and the second lot would be almost just short of 10,000 square feet. So even after the proposed subdivision, these lots are, they're almost close to being double what the requirements are in the zone. And so from a lot area's perspective, which is obviously one of the main components of a subdivision application and the requirements for a subdivision, this lot has ample area to accommodate two lots. The main issue that we've been having discussions with SAF and reviewing has had to do with lot width and lot width on a street. And so that's gonna be the main part of this application, is kind of walking through. And I just wanna, and please bear with me, just this question of lot width and going through it and how we've come to this current plan and why we feel this current plan is compliant and that the entire application is compliant and meets your subdivision regulations. The residency zone requires a lot width of 50 feet. The site currently has frontage along Lowndes Avenue. Along this northern boundary line here. It's an unbroken boundary line. It extends about 176 feet, which is more than three times the requirement as it heads out here. The site, however, borders Norwalk Harbor to its east, and you can see it here, but it also, which you may not be able to see or be indicated as well for the plan, but Norwalk Harbor actually comes in along the northern boundary line up to this point. And the pavement ends for Lowndes Avenue short, you know, obviously of the water. The pavement portion along Lowndes Avenue is a little over 72 feet. So lot width under your zoning regulations is defined as the horizontal distance between the sidelines of a lot measured at right angles to its depth along the street line. And the street line is defined under that same section as the dividing line between the street and the lot. So the northern boundary line is the dividing line, you know, obviously between the street and the lot. When we originally were looking at subdividing this site, we had actually looked about splitting this site down the middle and having a driveway on this very western side and for a lot here, and then another driveway closer towards the end of Lowndes Avenue. In conversations with staff, they had indicated that the lot width could only be measured for the length of pavement that the property line was along. So again, for this site, it's only 72.43. And you obviously couldn't get two 50-foot sections on that to get the lot width. Even though it's not specifically stated in the regulations about that requirement, we went and looked, engineer and I went and looked at this site and the survey, and we thought that due to its large size, it may be able to accommodate a private road where the proposed lots would have the requisite lot width on the private road rather than having it on Lowndes Avenue. And the reason being that the site, you could see this property line here that runs north-south is 126 feet. So greater than the, you know, it would be 100 feet for 250-foot sections. So it looked to us to be deep enough that if we did a private road, we could get the requisite lot width. So we consulted with the zoning department, with Ms. Maldonado, and she suggested that we contact the civil engineer for the city, Paul Sotnick, regarding a proposed private road. And I reviewed the city of Norwalk, the Department of Public Works roadway standards with Mr. Sotnick. And that document governs the design of private roads. And he highlighted a portion of the standards which permit dead-end alleys and specific design that he felt could be accommodated on the site. So if I could take you to that section. So these are the DPW standards. And you can see here, it talks about a type of private road known as an alley that can provide accessibility to land parcels and that they are characterized by a narrow right-of-way and range in width from 16 to 20 feet in residential areas. And that's, you know, obviously what we're looking at here. The dead-end alley that he pointed out, and you can see here in this section, says dead-end alley should be provided with a turning area in accordance with the figure on page 44. So if you go to page 44, and I'll turn this for you. There was this design, which is the design that he pointed out. And you can see here, it's that 20 feet in width requirement. There's a radius of 20 feet also required. And so this is the design we started working on for this subdivision. And it's the one that you'll eventually see is the one that's proposed tonight. Mr. Sotnick also suggested that we review this design for the private road with Fire Marshal Sawyer, Broderick Sawyer. I called him, I reviewed the plan, this design with him. We talked about the location of nearest fire hydrants and all sorts of other requirements. And at the end of that, he also expressed his belief that the private road would be able to meet city standards. And so with that, our engineer got to designing this subdivision plan that's before you. I also looked at the regulations, obviously, the subdivision regulations. And if I could show you, where is it right here? Sorry, let me flip this back around. And one of the, you know, one of the things was that I want to see is this type of alley allowed? And so in section 1.09, as you can see here of your regulations, street is defined to mean street, avenue, boulevard, highway, road, roadway, lane, alley. So it was included under this definition of street. It does create, it does contain this definition. I know this is mentioned in the comments from staff. It does mention a number of subsections to the street. Some streets are dead end streets, some streets are access ways, some are traveled ways, and some are cul-de-sacs. But these aren't requirements for every street because obviously these are all, you know, A through E, these subsections are all different from each other. But again, up here it says an alley is an acceptable street under the subdivision regulations. Another section I looked at was the private road section of your subdivision regulations, which says the private roads from a proposed subdivision or re-subdivision to an existing public street shall conform to all present city road standards. And you know, since we had reviewed that with the city engineer and the city fire marshal, we felt that we were, you know, we're working on a proposal for a private road subdivision that was compliant with your regulations. The first plan that we proposed, which you may have reviewed in one of your earlier packets, was this subdivision here, where you could see that alley design, the 20 feet in width, the 20 feet radiuses, that provided over 50 feet of lot width for both lots along this private road. Their sizes were over the 5,000 square feet that's required for the zone, and the lot width was over 50 feet. So we felt this plan was conforming to the design that had been pointed out. And we, in fact, had submitted this plan to Mr. Sotnick and Fire Marshal Sawyer to determine if we had designed it appropriately under the DPW standards. And they agreed. And so since conforming to the city standards was the requirement for the private road under subdivision regulations, you know, we felt we had come up with a compliant design. So I filed an application to this commission. Staff reviewed it and they had deemed it non-compliant. One of the issues that they highlighted was that the private road area that you could see here contained not only the pavement, but abutting landscaped area to a width of 50 feet, and its size was greater than 5,000, so that in their determination, they felt it constituted a third lot. I disagree with this interpretation. There's many road areas that also contain landscaped areas beyond the pavement. And even if the lot area and lot width of the private road area is compliant with the zoning standards for a building lot, it does not become a building lot because it's dedicated as a roadway that these lots front upon. There's many private roadways throughout Norwalk that exceed the lot width for their zone. They're not determined to be separate building lots. So, and on top of that, if this subdivision was ever recorded, it would just call this area out, this third lot out, as a private alley and for the road, not something that could be a building lot. But regardless, our engineer redesigned the plan to limit the private road to the actual area of the pavement, to the 20 feet that, again, is in compliance with that requirement for that's in the DPW standards. So this is the plan. This is the final plan. This is the plan that's before you tonight. Again, it's for the proposed alley, a private alley that would come off of Lowndes Avenue and provide access to both Lot A. There would be a driveway that would come out of Lot A right onto the private alley. That lot is a little over 9,000 square feet. It has over 50 feet of frontage, a lot width along the private road, and in compliance with the regulations. Similarly, the second lot, Lot B, has 9,783 square feet, again, well in excess of the lot area required for the zone, and also has 50 feet of lot width along this private road. So both are getting their lot, or meeting their lot width requirement on the private road. We had received a comment from staff that the frontage on Lowndes Avenue for Lot A would have to be below 50 feet, or it would turn Lot B into a rear lot. Again, it's something I disagree with because I just think it would make it a corner lot. But we were, when we did this redesign, the frontage of Lot A on Lowndes Avenue was reduced down to 42.43 feet. So it does not have compliant lot width. Lot A does not have compliant lot width on Lowndes Avenue. It just has it on the private road, just like Lot B. And again, the width of the proposed private road was reduced to the 20 feet, which was in compliance with the DPW standards. With regards to some of the requirements discussed by staff in its comments, particularly with in relation to curbs and sidewalks, the comments make it seem as if the regulations require those as mandatory, which they're not. Under the subdivision regulations, section 3.27 of the subdivision regulations concerning sidewalks state that sidewalks shall be required for all lots where the commission finds that use, intensity of development, and or safe pedestrian circulation warrant their installation. So therefore, you know, the requirement of sidewalks by the commission is actually discretionary. It's not mandatory. The subdivision regulations actually require the commission to make a finding that's enumerated in the section for sidewalks to be required. For this particular site, one thing I want to note is that both lots actually do have access to existing sidewalks. Lot A has them right out to Lowndes Avenue in this section right here, but also Lot B in our redesign, we redesigned it so Lot B would be able to access the sidewalk on Lowndes Avenue as well. But on top of that, we don't think it's the type of intense development that would warrant sidewalks. It's only two lots. They both have direct access. So we don't think it's a type of development that warrants that, but we could easily add sidewalks here along within the private properties here. There's obviously plenty of lot area to give to do that. With regards to the other requirement, which is concerning curbs, Section 3.28 of the subdivision regulations concerning curbs state that curbs shall be required for all lots where the commission finds that the site conditions, including use, intensity of development, say pedestrian or vehicular traffic movement, stormwater drainage, and or street gradients warrant their installation. Again, it's a requirement under the subdivision regulations that's discretionary. It's not mandatory. It requires a finding that it's intense enough that it warrants it. We don't feel, again, on such a small development, a two-lot development, that they are necessary. But it is, again, something we could easily add here along these sidewalks if the commission found that they were necessary. The one of the other comments from the staff found that Lot B is a rear lot. And the zoning regulations define rear lot as a lot situated to the rear of lots fronting on a street and having access to the street via an access way, which is in the same ownership as the rear lot. We don't feel that Lot B fits this definition for two reasons. First, Lot A does not have compliant lot width on Lowndes Avenue. That was one of the things that we worked on and we redesigned, bringing it down to, you know, just over 42 feet, but under the 50 feet that's required. Its compliant lot width, or its, you know, front of the property is on the private road. And Lot B, you know, abuts it to the side with its front also on the private road. So really, the front of this Lot A is not Lowndes Avenue. The front is the private road, and therefore Lot B is not to the rear. The second issue with that is that the proposed private road is not an access way, and it will not be in the same ownership as Lot B. An access way is defined in section 1.09B of the subdivision regulations as a private right-of-way for vehicular traffic serving not more than one rear lot. The proposed private road does not just serve Lot B. It's serving both lots A and B. So it doesn't meet the definition of access way as defined. And on top of that, the proposal in our application, the private road will not be in the same ownership as Lot B. Lot A has to maintain ownership as well because the private road is its access. So the property owners will have to form a private road association, which will own the proposed private road, in which both lot owners will have an interest, which is something common to a lot of private road neighborhoods. They form an association, and all the lots that use that private road contribute to the maintenance of it, the landscaping, the paving, the plowing, and it's owned by the private road association. And that would be the same in this instance. The staff did comment that the alley does in fact meet the city's dimensional standards. And in our opinion, based on section 3.24 of the subdivision regulations, that private road reg that I read to you, it makes this private road in the subdivision compliant because the requirement under there is that it meets the city's standards, and we do, and staff made a statement that we do meet those dimensional standards. So we believe that this application is compliant with your subdivision regulations as a two-lot subdivision. But I will point out that this commission has the ability to waive standards under your section 3.29 of the subdivision regulations. And although we don't believe that cul-de-sac streets or sidewalks and curbs are required under the subdivision regulations, this commission, we believe, has the discretion under that standard to waive the standards that are referenced by the staff in their comments. And it's actually something that this commission has done before. I can just get to, sorry, I'm skipping to a, yes. So this was a subdivision application for a three-lot subdivision of the property located at 77.5 Ohio Avenue Extension in Lower Rocks Road. And that this waiver standard was used to waive the same standards mentioned in the staff comments regarding cul-de-sacs, sidewalks, and curbs. This property in this application was located at the very end of a private road. It actually didn't even extend the whole way. If you look here, and I don't know if I have the drawing feature, but if you could see here, there was a private road. It was only 15 feet in width, Lower Rocks Road, that came down and stopped right here. And a subdivision was approved that created this lot and then these two smaller lots. And they had 50 feet. It wasn't, the road ended here, and then there was almost like a driveway that extended out, but it was found to have compliant lot width along Lower Rocks Road because even though the road didn't extend, there was this, property area that extended down in front of the these two lots. It didn't have sidewalks. It didn't have curbing. It almost is it's a very similar layout to the subdivision application we're proposing, and the commission did waive those standards in that case. I found other similar small private road developments, including Blue Mountain Court. This is a picture of Blue Mountain Court. Let me turn it again so you can see it properly. Okay, here we go. Here's Blue Mountain Court. No cul-de-sac. You can see there's no sidewalks here. Again, not required of it. And then another one, Katy Lane, again, smaller development, so there's no sidewalks, no curbing, no cul-de-sac. So we believe this subdivision application is fully compliant with the regulations. We believe the requirements of a cul-de-sac, sidewalks, and curbing are discretionary. And this particular application, due to the fact it's only a two-lot subdivision, we don't believe those requirements are necessary. We've designed an alley that is permitted under the subdivision regulations. And is compliant with the standards, the DPW standards that are referenced in the regulations. We can accommodate the sidewalks and curbing. Again, we have plenty of room on the site. We have plenty of lot area. But if the commission did feel that they were required, we also believe that the commission has the ability under the regulations to waive those requirements. Finally, the application, because it's a subdivision application, it does, and it's in a coastal area, subdivision applications do get reviewed for coastal site plan review. So that is, that is before you as well. And we had our experts submit how we satisfy the requirements of the state statute, and then we're consistent with the goals and policy of the Coastal Management Act. I will point out, and I had referenced this at the beginning of the presentation, that the deep comments refer to a proposed new dwelling location. And to be clear again, we're not proposing a dwelling tonight under this application. The application only concerns the subdivision and the improvements required for the subdivision, which is, mainly at this point, is just the private road. The comments talked about the location, possible location of a dwelling within the VE flood zone. But with our latest design, one thing I'll point out is we do have, you can see here, the line running through the site that divides the AE and the VE flood zone. And there's considerable area within the AE portion of the sites of these proposed lots where we feel that we could locate a dwelling. And again, if this application were to be approved tonight, no house could be built on these lots. We would have to come back, and our intent would be to come back to you with an application for the dwellings for coastal site plan review. That would be required of them. I appreciate the commission's patience again. It has been a lot of reviewing of the language and of the requirements of the subdivision regulations, but we feel that we have met the requirements with two lots that are well above the lot area requirement for the residency zone, but now they also have the required lot width in excess of 50 feet on both lot A and B. And even beyond the technical nature that comes with subdivision applications, we feel this application meets the intent of subdivision regulations and the zoning regulations, which in a global sense are there to ensure that appropriate buffers are placed between properties and between other dwellings. And we can easily do that and be conforming to the neighborhood with this proposed application. Our lots are still, even after the subdivision, well above the lot area of the lots that abut us and are in this residency zone. A lot of them are 5,000, 6,500. We're proposing are over 9,000. Certainly I think this design, as shown by some of the examples I've shown, is consistent with other private road subdivisions and private road developments that you have in the city. These lots will have the ability to sufficiently buffer from those lots, from neighboring lots, and really fit in, I think, with the character of this neighborhood. So again, appreciate your patience in listening to the presentation. I appreciate the time. I know staff took a lot of review of different iterations and different comments that we made, and then also the city engineer and the fire marshal. So appreciate the time that they spent on it as well. But we'd respectfully request your approval, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Before we get to questions from commission members, An awful lot of what you said tonight is fairly technical. Mm-hmm. I'd like to hear from the staff their comments on this. Steve?
I can share a few words, and maybe Steve, I don't know, or Steve, do you want to?
No, go ahead. I'll jump in after. Go ahead.
Okay. So yeah, I think both teams, staff and the applicant, really line by line for the subdivision regulations and the roadway standards, taking a look at this application. And I think what stems from the major item that is not compliant and the major issue with the lot was that lot width, not having it on the city road. So trying to come up with a solution, creating the alley, I think the configuration as it stands doesn't meet the lot width definition. And then it doesn't front on ultimately a private road needs to be a publicly city accepted road. So the proposed alley isn't a city road. The city wouldn't develop a road that looked like that. And then subsequently the frontage isn't on that road. So I think that's like the major hard-hitting item that why this application doesn't comply. I know he brought up some other scenarios on Ohio Ave and Blue Mountain Court. I think a big difference between those, Blue Mountain Court, that's a conservation development, different standards, not a subdivision. And then it all also comes down to when the subdivision regulations came into play, what kind of standards are there at the time when the road is developed. So that is also something to consider when taking a look at different, comparing different subdivisions. So that's kind of pieces I had. Steve, do you have more?
Yeah, and I'll be very brief. I mean, I think it's pretty obvious that this is a odd situation. It's an odd piece of property with the configuration of where the street ends. Had Lowndes actually continued down another 27 feet or so, it probably would have been approved several months ago as a conventional two-lot subdivision. I concur with the applicant that it's an oversized parcel for the area. And I mean, I think from our perspective and just backing up what Michelle said, I don't think it's anything for us. It's just doesn't, our opinion doesn't conform to the minimal standards for a lot width. I think the fact, just because the DPW standards, which haven't been addressed in, you know, I think those are from the 1980s, I think was never the intent to have these alleys serving as roads. I mean, you could look at the language within DPW standards for alleys, and it kind of points you in a different direction of what the intent of those are to be used for. You know, my vision of an alley is kind of much different than what's laid out in that regulation. And even the terminology used there has talking about the alley being parallel with the street and the alley connecting to another alley should be what the desired point is. So I think it's not meant to be a road in terms of requirements for subdivision. As they have proposed the layout, it to me, it's almost a way around creating a rear lot. That's just kind of what they, I mean, I'll give them credit. It's a creative way, but I don't think it's a legal way, in my opinion. I think, you know, initially the applicant had sought a variance to try to, for that lot width question. Had that been granted, again, that would have come to you as a complying two lot subdivision and, you know, probably would have been acted on and approved already. But I think just staff's opinion is that the width question is unresolved. And I think to me, it's largely due to the unique nature of this property. It's not, for us, it's not, you know, a major decision one way or other. It's a, you know, a large two lot subdivision, but again, it's just a simple application with complex lot width questions.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Michelle. Questions from members of the commission? All right. If not, Tammy, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Sorry, you know, I always have a question. Mr. Russo, did you or your client ever consider if you put one large house and then an ADU on the property, an accessory dwelling unit?
Well, we have considered, you know, developing it as a single lot. But, you know, he asked me, again, it's, and I think this is what Director Kleppen is speaking to. It's a really unique lot, and it is so large for the zone. And, you know, so we looked at it, and I reviewed the regulations with my client, and it was like, well, and this thing's over four times the size. So shouldn't it be able to be subdivided? So,
I mean, I get it. It's obviously the highest and best use for the landowner. And then I guess this is addressed to Steve or Michelle. Do you know why we don't allow rear lots in the C zone?
I think it, and I, Michelle, correct me if I'm wrong. I believe that they're also not allowed in the B zone too. Is that correct? And I think that's largely due to the minimum lot size requirement in that zone. It's the smallest area and width wide of the single family or in, you know, the C residential zone case of two family zones, where the larger lots, there's more space and it there's less congestion, I guess, of where the structures would be located on those rear lots.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions before we open it up to the public? All right. If not, Michelle, do you want to explain how people can access the site?
Sure. So at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a raise your hand tool. Use that. And if you raise your hand, we'll bring you over to speak. Please remember to state your name and address for the record. And then if you're dialed in on a phone, press *9 to raise your hand. Okay. Beverly, you just have to unmute.
Okay, thank you, Michelle. So my name is Beverly Krieger, and I live very close to this parcel at 9 Seabreeze Place, Norwalk, Connecticut. It is important to note that this is a waterfront parcel. And when you say, Mr. Russo, that you're not increasing the density by much, in fact, you would be doubling the density on this waterfront parcel. Isn't that correct with your proposed plan?
Beverly, for the public comment part, it won't be a back and forth. Just state all your questions and concerns, all right, and everyone will follow up.
And it would appear that you're doubling the density. And you're also making possible, because due to the size of these parcels, where there was one dwelling unit with a accessory dwelling, a small accessory dwelling that I think was once a garage, if I recall correctly, you are now creating the possibility, if I understand the rules correctly, if this is approved, of having four good sized dwelling units on that property. For example, two large two family, if you want to call them, a condominium style. I don't know how you would fashion it, but that would be what I think is allowed. And that would greatly increase the density for the neighborhood and on the waterfront parcel. You'll also, and I don't know if this is a consideration for the Planning and Zoning Commission today, there would be increased runoff from this development. It is the waterfront on three sides. I think much of this was originally filled in land, as a matter of fact, historically. I also wanted to question you about your existing survey that you showed the commission and showed to the public. My understanding from walking by that property very frequently is that that existing survey is not accurate, that those buildings that survey shows have been removed. So currently there are no buildings on that property. A couple of other points. It certainly is pretty clear that it's not compliant from your diagram because you don't have the requisite width on Lowndes Avenue. I mean, to me, I'm not a planning and zoning person, but it certainly looks like it's a driveway that you're creating so that you could get around this rear lot rule. If you want to call it a road, you're going to have a road that's very close to somebody's side yard. And I don't think, you know, that's going to impact the people who live in the adjacent parcel significantly if it's going to be a road rather. So, and additionally, with all the, with the intensity of the development, there's going to be a lot more traffic along there. And that's going to impact the end of Lowndes Avenue and that neighborhood. I think it creates the ability to create too intensive a level of development for that particular waterfront location. So I thank you for a great presentation, but that's my sense of what it is. Thank you. And I'd love to hear your comments back.
Thank you. Other comments from the public?
So again, use the raise your hand feature if you'd like to speak now.
Is it star 9, Michelle, by phone?
And then star 9 with a phone. Don't see any.
Okay. Then we'll turn it back to Mr. Russo.
Thank you, Chair. Just a couple of responses. One, Director Kleppen had talked about the alleys, and if I can, get back to the definition here, and if I understood him correctly, he didn't feel that the alleys were intended for residential. But if you do look at the DPW standards, it does specifically state alleys provide for accessibility and service to each individual land parcel. They are characterized by a narrow right of way and range in width from 16 to 20 feet in residential areas. It also provides for what would be required in industrial areas, but clearly it was also contemplated for residential areas. It says so right here. And the dead end alley is something that's specifically called out. Dead end alley should be provided with a turning area in accordance with the figure on page 44. So it does talk in a section about alleys which may eventually intersect in certain situations, but it also provides a provision for dead end alleys and then refers specifically to this figure, which is the figure that we used in our design. And those regs may be a bit out to date, but the as I don't know if they've been updated since the 80s, but still the regulations, the subdivision regulations are clear in saying that private roads from a proposed subdivision or subdivision to an existing public street shall conform to all present city road standards. And the present city road standards are the DPW standards, which is what we designed to. So as it stands now, we feel we comply with this section 3.24 and the DPW standards. Regarding the other comment, just wanna go back here. If this property was not on Norwalk Harbor and simply didn't have Norwalk Harbor intrude into this area, and it had this 176 feet that this property line is, was fronted on Lowndes Avenue, it would have the lot area and it would have the lot width for three separate lots, which each could have two family dwellings. So it has the size and the lot width for a much more intense development, but for the fact that Norwalk Harbor comes in on the site. And that unique condition is what pushed us to consider the private road for a two-lot subdivision, even though it's got plenty of lot area for a three-lot, to do a two-lot subdivision. So for this size, if you take the next three properties to the west of this site, in their lot areas, in their lot width, they are a lot more dense than what we're proposing here on a similar square and the size that this site is. With regarding to drainage, this site has no drainage. It's a very old site. It hasn't been touched for a long time. And we're proposing compliant drainage under the city's current standards. So this site will get improved drainage were this to be approved. And then with regarding the survey, so yes, this survey, when this application was submitted a long time ago. And in that time, my client's been working to, one, we had an asbestos issue there. So he had to go through a whole process in removing the asbestos. And then we also had a issue with some people trespassing. And so for those reasons, we moved forward in tearing down the two structures, which was the original proposal anyway, was to tear down these structures. So if it was updated for today, it would show these two structures removed. Those are two non-conforming structures. The main house was non-conforming as the street setback. The house to the south was non-conforming as to rear setback. So those have been removed. So those non-conformities have been removed from the site. And anything that would be built in the future would have to be fully compliant with the regulations, which is what our client's seeking to do.
Mr. Russo, I don't think that the fact that those buildings are gone goes to the heart of the matter here. It doesn't matter to me. Okay. What is a little upsetting is that what you've shown, and that is those two buildings, means that you really have not given us an accurate map of this property.
But it was at the time. It was at the time, Chair. That's my only response.
But today,
it was at the time. Today, I mean, I'm happy to provide an updated survey with it knocked down, you know, as it exists exactly today. But
well, as I said, it doesn't. In terms of at least the way I evaluate this, I think it's irrelevant to whether this gets approved or not. That's not my argument. My argument is that this evening you should have provided us with the updated survey. That's it. go ahead.
I apologize. We didn't have the surveyor go back out to be able to do that. Those structures are no longer there, which was the original intent of the, as was expressed in the application as originally submitted, which was that those would be torn down.
Do we have other questions from commission members? If not, Mr. Russo, any final comment?
No, that's it, Chair. Again, we feel this application is fully compliant with your subdivision regulations, and also that the subdivision application itself, not the dwellings, which is not before you, are also consistent with the Coastal Management Act, its goals and policies. The road itself is located outside of the VE flood zone. We've submitted from our expert and his opinion that we are consistent with that act and respectfully request your approval.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll close the hearing and move on to action. Is there a motion from members of the commission to either approve or deny the application?
Do we have a resolution?
I could bring it up if you'd like.
Sure, why don't you do that?
Or deny.
All right. Michelle, can we see the motion to approve?
Staff did not recommend one.
Okay, no, that's fine. That doesn't mean that we can't enter a motion to approve. Is there a motion to approve? Darius, you wanna move approval?
Yes, I move that we approve.
Mr. Is there a second? Tammy, you're seconding? Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Williams and a second by Ms. Langalis. Is there any comment? I think there ought to be something on the record on this. I think that at least some of this argument by Mr. Russo has been somewhat tortured. I think at least for me, others obviously may have different opinions. It may be unfortunate, but this does not appear to comply with our regulations. And as a result, I'm going to have to vote against it. Again, comments from anyone else? If not, then let's proceed to a vote.
I'll make one comment. A vote against the, a no vote on the resolution to approve is basically the same as a yes vote on the resolution to deny. I would imagine the outcome would be similar. Is that?
That is correct.
Yeah. So, all right. I'm also not going to support this. So, when we get to that point.
Nonetheless, we do need to vote on it. Steve, let's do a roll call.
Certainly. Ms. Jordan Byron?
I'm going to abstain.
Mr. Williams?
No.
Ms. Langalis?
Yes.
Mr. Muschak?
No.
And Mr. Shulman?
No. The motion to approve fails and the project is not approved.
I'm going to suggest that we actually do another vote with the resolution to deny.
That's what reason, Mike?
To put that into the record.
All right, let's I'm not sure.
Why would you do that?
I'm not sure this is at all necessary.
Well, on a recent application, I believe staff had suggested that it would have been better to vote yes for a resolution to deny than it would be to have voted no on a resolution to approve.
Well, then maybe the resolution should have been written that way. Like, don't we have to go with what the staff?
Well, we didn't actually have a resolution. The resolution to approve was what the motion was that we just voted. But there really was no wording for the resolution to approve, was there?
Well, Mike, let me point this out to you. This evening, and this is frankly, I think a first for us. There are only 5 members of the commission here. So any no vote will keep the motion that you're referring to from being approved. We've already denied the project, but if we now vote on denying it, we have someone who's already voted in favor of it. Should she vote against the motion to deny, that motion will not pass. Because we need five members voting in favor to pass anything this evening.
Okay.
And I understand what you said, and you may very well be right on that point. But if it's not going to pass, why go through the motions?
It's above my pay grade, as they say.
Do you get paid for this?
Well, seems that way, but no, I don't.
I'm sorry, Mr. Russo. All right, let's move on. We have three public hearings tonight.
Mr. Chairman, may I bring up one point? I was just, while you were just going through that, just point of clarification.
Yeah.
Sorry, Attorney Sutchy was popping up there. Let me just pull up what I wanted to show you. I was looking at the bylaws quick, just because I was thinking about that very question. Can you guys see that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, so I think it has to do with quorum and voting. So just
we can't see, Steve. All we can see is
let me try that again. Hold on. Okay. I pulled up the wrong. All right, how's that?
Yes.
That's better.
Yeah. So just this would have gone to the last thing you were just talking about in terms of your ability to vote and what constitutes an approval. I believe the old bylaws had a provision there about five votes. So if you have five to constitute a quorum, which is you.
Oh, I see what it says. So we don't need five votes. If we vote to deny, we simply need a majority.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. I haven't looked at the bylaws in a little while, and I had completely forgotten that.
Me so, too. I pulled those out quick to double check that.
So, is there a motion to approve motion to deny?
I'll make that motion.
And Mike has made that motion. Is there a second? And Darius is seconding. Discussion?
Hey, Steve, can you send me a copy of those bylaws?
Yeah, certainly.
Thank you.
All right. Steve, can you pull up the motion to deny?
Like,
sorry, thank you, Michelle.
Is this what was in our packet?
Yes.
Right? Yes, it was.
The draft resolution to deny. So, I mean, not to beat a dead horse, but maybe this was what we should have presented the first time instead of doing it the other way around.
We had a motion and we had a second. Once we've gone that far, I think we have an obligation to vote on that motion. But otherwise, I think you're correct.
Okay.
Okay. Any discussion on the motion? All right, if not, let's do a roll call. This is a motion to deny the applicant's request for approval.
Okay, Mr. Williams?
Yes.
Ms. Jordan Byron?
Abstain.
Ms. Langalas?
No.
Mr. Muschak?
Yes.
And Mr. Shulman?
Yes. That is a majority, and so it passes. Okay, let's move on to 2022-49 SP CAM, 129 Woodward Avenue, LLC, 129 Woodward Avenue, reuse of the existing building as a commercial recreation establishment. And who, Attorney Succi, you're going to represent the property owner?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Shulman, Mr. Chairman, and members of the commission. Thank you for your time this evening. For the record, my name is Liz Succi. I'm a partner at Carmody Torrent Sandeck and Hennessy, 1055 Washington Boulevard in Stamford. And I represent the applicant, 129 Woodward Ave, LLC. Present for tonight's meeting are Peter Romano of LandTech. He is the project engineer. Ethan Shikoski of Atlantic Traffic, traffic engineer. Mike Tierney of Rogers McCagg, the project architect. And also present tonight are Mark Fischel, who is, I believe, dialing in from South America while he's on vacation, and Patricio Mizitrano. Both are principals in 129 Woodward Avenue. And they have all the knowledge and information that I won't be able to provide you with on both padel and pickleball. should you have any questions for me or any of the consultants or Mr. Mizitrano, Mr. Fischel, during this hearing, please don't hesitate to stop us and we'll certainly answer any questions you may have. By way of background, the application for special permit and CAM were filed on September 19th. Neighbors were notified of that filing on September 28th by certificate of mailing, and that certificate should be in the file. Neighbors were subsequently notified of tonight's public hearing by certified mail return receipt requested on November 1st, and the green cards were returned to staff today, along with tracking letters from the U.S. Postal Service for those letters for which we have not received the green cards as yet. As indicated, the applicant is 129 Woodward Avenue, LLC. It's the contract purchaser of a just almost 3-acre parcel of land on the west side of Woodward Avenue. It is block two, taxing district two, block 91, lot 89B. At the time of the submission of this application, it was prior to your zone change and map changes. The property was zoned C residence for the first 100 feet of depth from Woodward Avenue westbound, and the remainder of the property was restricted industrial. So the application was filed under the old restricted industrial zone classification and regulations that existed at the time. And now you've rezoned this parcel to industrial number two. If I may ask Mr. Romano, if he could, to screen share the zoning location survey, that would be great while we're moving forward. So the existing conditions, it's a 38,000, almost 39,000 square foot high bay warehouse building that was constructed around 2007. The building was recently renovated because of some settling, some issues with the building. So there was some work done in 2020. There are approximately 32 parking spaces that exist today around the perimeter, the southern perimeter of the property along the property line. As you'll see on this screen, the first 100 feet in from the right is green. That's because that portion of the property was zoned C residence and nothing was ever built along that portion of the property. That C residence classification also extended southward on Woodward Avenue in front of many of the other warehouse buildings that exist on that street. The proposal is to adaptively reuse this facility and create an indoor commercial recreation facility, which will have 5 padel courts, 4 pickleball courts, 2 golf simulators, and a mezzanine area where players can watch play that's being undertaken on the courts below, or sit and have a drink and gather with their friends before or after they play. We anticipate being able to accommodate 60 parking spaces on site, and that's what the site plan shows. There is some additional area where we can accommodate a few more parking spaces. We are investigating solar panels if possible, but I don't think they're going to be feasible, but we certainly will investigate them, as I know that is something Commissioner Cantor usually requests us to do. And also the availability and appropriateness of EV chargers on the site, as Commissioner Wells usually asks us to do. We're investigating the implementation of those on the site as well. Hours of operation, generally, 7 days a week, 7 a.m. to 11 p.m., 3 to 4 staff people daily. There are no proposed exterior modifications to the building. No new lighting on the exterior of the buildings. All activity will take place from within. And indulge me for just a minute. For those of you who are unfamiliar with padel and pickleball, as I was before I met the client, pickleball is a racket paddleball sport where there are two or four players on the court. It's very similar to tennis. It's one of the fastest growing sports in the US. It originated in the mid 1960s in Bainbridge Island in Washington. The USA Pickleball Association has nearly 4,000 locations nationwide, and more than 4.5 million people play it. In the past 2 years, the sport has grown by nearly 40%. I suspect if former Commissioner Sumter was here, he'd be very excited about this and be able to tell us a lot about pickleball. So I do know that he has started to play this sport. There are outdoor courts similar to this in Darien, Cheshire and Fairfield, and an indoor facility in Oxford, with one set to open in Milford. Pickleball may become an Olympic sport by the 2024 Games in Paris or the 2028 Games in Los Angeles if it meets the various criteria established by the International Olympic Committee. For those of you who may want to find out more about pickleball, if you are inclined to approve this application tonight and take interest in the sport, tomorrow night on CBS from 9 to 11 p.m., a show called Pickled will air, hosted by none other than Stephen Colbert, with a variety of celebrity players playing tomorrow night. So we'll get to see what the sport is like in action. Padel is the secondary sport that would be played in this facility if it's approved. And it's not to be confused with paddle tennis or platform tennis, which I presumed was the sport when Patricio Mizutrano and Mark Fischel first spoke to me. It is, however, another fast-growing racket sport. It's played generally in a doubles format on about a third of the size of a tennis court, originated in 1969 in Mexico. And it is greatly popular in Spain, Latin America, Italy, Qatar, Sweden, and other countries. In the US, it's governed by the US Padel Association. And there are about 70 padel courts in the US with in Brooklyn. It too hopes to be recognized as an Olympic sport over the next few years. The application that's before you and Mr. Romano will speak to you about the site plan and stormwater management and those issues next, has been reviewed and approved by Public Works, Fire, South Norwalk Electric and Water, Health, Transportation, Mobility and Parking, and those sign-offs are in the file. We had expected to receive the WPCA sign-off today, but that just simply didn't come in. There was not enough time for it to be finally reviewed by Mr. Geron and a sign-off sent to you. We have also some comments received from Ms. Williams in her review of the application relating to FEMA compliance and parking. And I'm fully confident that with the expertise and experience of our team and the input from staff, we can address those issues to her satisfaction, either prior to the issuance of a zoning permit or a certificate of zoning compliance, with either some revisions to the interior space or creation of exterior parking space to satisfy the parking needs. So at this point, I'd like Mr. Romano to walk me through the site plan, if he would, and he'll be followed by Mike Tierney of Rogers McCagg, and then finally Ethan Shikoski of Atlantic Traffic. And again, should you have any questions of me or anyone else, we'd be happy to answer them at any time. Peter?
Good evening, everyone. I am Pete Romano, principal with Landtech, a site civil engineer firm out of Westport, representing the traffic as usual. I'll just take a few slides. So real briefly, Liz pretty much summed it up. Existing site right now is in fact a warehouse.
Mr. Romano, I can't speak for anybody else, but I'm having difficulty understanding you.
Me too. He's very garbled.
There might be just some paper in front of your microphone. That's happened to me before.
Let's try that. Is that any better?
That's better.
Yes, yeah. It is.
Okay. I know it's been happening recently. Again, Pete Romano, Landtech, site civil engineering firm out of Westport, representing the applicants. Liz took you through pretty much a little bit of the site. The site right now is an existing warehouse, a little industrial site. It's got some parking and pretty much the same that's out there right now. We kind of brought it up to current standards. Let me take you through this. Let me just move this around a little bit. We're having a little difficulty showing this all that. Okay, I'm sorry. Can you see the full site plan? I'm having a little trouble displaying it. So
yes, we can see it.
Yeah,
we can. I'm sorry, something's bouncing around my computer. I don't know what it is. So the site right now is, like I said, just about a little over 2.5, almost 3 acres of property. Driveway comes in, sort of tees up with Loudoun's Avenue right across the street. Keeping the same driveway, we sort of swept it a little bit more so we capture some additional parking. Like Lynn says, there's 60 parking spaces, a couple handicap spaces. And she asked me this today as I was in my car, didn't realize we do actually have the EV stations at the far end of the parking lot, or rather the west side of the parking space. There's 4 of them there right now. The site plan, for the most part, just brings everything up to the current City of Norwalk site plan standards. We've provided parking islands and landscaping and screening. There is a little bit of wetlands down in the lower right-hand corner, which would be the southeast corner. Liz alluded to the fact that we might be able to capture some additional parking spaces there. Subsequent to our submission to PNZ, we approached Conservation Office and Alexis Cherichetti particularly. The wetlands that are down in the lower right-hand corner, there actually is a remnants of a stream that has gotten piped except for the last little section of it. And we approached Alexis about the possibility of reconfiguring that, making it more valuable wetlands than what's there right now, and then be able to capture about 6 or 7 more parking spaces along that southerly property line. This piece of property, unlike many that you've seen in the upper uplands areas of Norwalk, we didn't need to capture the quantity of storm drainage here. It was mainly the quality of stormwater. And so everything's collected in the parking lot, catch basins with sumps and trapwoods, gets discharged to underground filtration system that overflows to that channel that runs to the subway corner of the property and then off our property. That storm drainage also compensates for any excess runoff from our property. There's a little bit more parking area you can see to the southeast corner of the building. There's some new parking spaces there. The handicap spaces are there. We've actually reduced some of the pavement up against the building from before. This is all the light green areas, all lawn area that's been created. A little bit was asphalt pavement in the past. I'll take you to one of the other sheets here. We've actually done a couple of. This is our sight line coming out of the property. We have adequate sight line in both directions, over 180 feet in both directions. We did a little analysis of how vehicles and truck traffic come in and out of our piece of property. So like I said, while the site was pretty much developed, we kind of brought it up to the current site plan standards for the city of Norwalk. I think, as was mentioned at the beginning, this actually happens to be in the coastal area management area, and we provided an impact statement and a little report that confirms that we are consistent with the coastal resources standards outlined in report 30 for the coastal area management site plan applications. So I'm happy to answer any questions.
Mr. Romano, can you go back to that aerial view of the building?
Sure.
That roof doesn't look like there's much there. I'm wondering why Liz indicated that she didn't think that solar voltaics would be able to work here.
I can answer that a little bit. And I think what Liz said, because she wasn't sure what we could or couldn't write there, many times, if the roof is not structurally sound to support the photo cells on the roof, that sometimes can be a consideration that they can't put them on there. We didn't know enough to say one way or the other right now whether you could or could not.
And is that as far as you know, the only issue, whether the roof can support it?
That's what is the issue when you can't put them on it. I mean, look, you're staring at it. It looks like an ideal spot to put it. Right. I suspect it, right? But I'm going to tell you, we have, at least our office hasn't looked into it, but many times that happens to be, that sometimes is the concern about adding those to the roofs.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. I've completed my application. It's pretty straightforward, our work. You know, it's we basically, as I said, brought the site up to current standards of the city in Ottawa. So I'm happy to answer any questions, and I'll be here the rest of the night.
I have a question, Mikey. The landscape plan shows three new dogwoods on the south side of the driveway along the street. And you see those. And I don't see the existing trees shown, but the existing trees are in good shape. As far as I could tell, these alcovas that were there, and I think they were planted as part of the city tree planting plan over the years, which I used to be involved with a long time ago. But were those meant to replace any of those trees or supplement them? Because I don't think they're needed there.
I did not do the landscaping plan, but looks like the way they're placed, it looks like they're in addition to.
Yeah.
Would be my guess, but it's something we can look at once again.
Yeah, I don't think they'd be necessary. I think those trees are doing fine.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, they're doing fine. And if anything, I would say keep the trees on the plant list and just cluster them to the left of the, you know, like, so I'm using my arrow, which nobody can see, of course, but it would be a little to the left, move your arrow over to the left. And then down a little bit. Yeah, like right in.
So you put them in there. Okay.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't even want to hide the building so much as over closer to the parking area. Like just cluster three right there. Yeah, okay. Right there.
Sure, I got you.
and then the existing trees that are along the facade of the building itself, if you go up, and they were just showing in the photo that you showed.
Yeah.
Those would stay too, I assume, right?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, they weren't shown on the plan. You had the existing trees shown along the street.
Right.
That's why I was confused, because I thought, I guess they're showing all the existing plants that they're going to keep. And I remember when those trees were required a long time ago, when this was originally approved, and most of them are doing pretty well. Sandy came after this was put in and killed a few of them off, but the rest of them have grown pretty big. And so that makes a nice view when you're coming down Lowndes, because the building is kind of a big blank space on the right side of the building. In any case, I'm rambling now. Thank you. I would say just moving those dogwoods around and keeping the plant list the same would be sufficient.
Great suggestion. I will certainly take a look as we move forward more closely as to the viability of solar voltaic panels on the roof. And that's typically, as all of you are well aware, has been often a condition of approval to consider those. And if there's a reason why they can't be incorporated into a final design, to let you know what the rationale is. But we'll certainly look at those.
Thank you.
At this point, if I have no other questions for Mr. Romano, I'd like Michael Tierney to just walk you briefly through the floor plan.
Sure. I had a question when everyone took a break.
Go ahead, JJ.
Okay, so my question is to anyone on the panel. In regards to the indoor recreation, in this particular area, there is a school that will be built, and I'm wondering, will you have a relationship with the students at this school for instruction in pickleball?
That's an excellent question, Commissioner. And as a matter of fact, I've had these conversations directly with Mr. Fischel, and he has expressed an interest to have a relationship and to expose kids in the neighborhood and adults to these two sports. So that is something we will be exploring as well. But thank you very much for that question.
And one additional question. This area, will there be a sidewalk built anywhere around the perimeter of this building in order to allow for pedestrian walkway?
Peter, there's sidewalk.
There are sidewalks all around the building. They're all along the front. We have a new entranceway here with sidewalk. We're using a decorative brick. And of course, there's sidewalks out on Woodward. Is that?
Because the aerial view that you showed has, you are surrounded by containers. You're by all this trucks and containers and various industrial usage. Yeah. And so it's hard to see if there is actually a sidewalk.
There's no sidewalk around the back of the building. This is all lawn. There's no reason for anybody to be going back there. Hmm. There is a sidewalk all along the parking.
Okay.
And the entrance into the building itself.
Right.
Nothing goes around the building.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, I'm going to share my screen. It's Michael Tierney from Rogers McKeag here in South Norwalk. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
All right, this is the existing condition, the warehouse as it stands. Currently, there's only several bathrooms and a mechanical room. There is an existing loading dock. You're looking at the front of the building. This is what Peter was referring to, where the sidewalk was going to be and the area of new lawn. We're not changing the access or the public entrance to the building. It all is in the southeast corner of the building, which it was when originally designed. It's a little over 35,000 square feet, the existing footprint. We're not changing anything. The only thing that we're doing is on the exterior is we are proposing a wall-mounted sign above the actual entrance. This is the southeast corner existing entrance. We're not changing window locations. We're not breaking the envelope anywhere. We're just proposing adding the sign. Let's go back to the plan. On the first floor, you'll see we've got four pickle courts, which essentially reside on the west side, plan west side, and then five padel courts. I've got a couple of images of the relationship of a padel court versus a pickleball court. And these are representative of what Mark and Patricio are proposing. The pickleball courts, which is on the right-hand side, will be perimetered with a chain link fence just to capture the ball and create a boundary of the court area. It's a conventional tennis layout. You have a net in the center and playing fields and a kitchen on each side. Kitchen is this area. Padel court is, as Liz said, talked about doubles play. It does have at each end a perimeter wall that is played off of during the actual play itself. And the center portion is essentially netted with a opening to access the court itself. Same similar setup, back area and two front lobes. So that is what would be on these plans. I'll zoom in onto a padel court. The actual wall areas are defined in plan, such as this. There'll be seating arrangements in between all of the courts for viewing areas. On the first floor, we enter in off of Pete's nice new sidewalk entry. You'll enter into a lounge area. There'll be a reception desk with cubbies, some storage cubbies for people using the site, two offices. There'll be two sets of restrooms, which will include a shower, sort of suite condition with lavatory. We're leaving the existing doors, which hopefully will be glazed so that there'll be natural light coming in. There is a area that is segregated off from the first floor area that will be storage access for upstairs. I'll talk about that after. There'll be a communicative stair or public stair up to the upper lounge area that Liz referred to. But on the first floor, there'll also be two golf simulators, as well as a small bar area and viewing area with some tables and chairs. The simulators will also have their own sort of high top seating and viewing chairs for people not actually using the simulator. There'll be a storage area which will support the facility with cleaning, janitorial equipment, stuff such like that. And the existing mechanical room is to remain. All utilities and electric come into this room at this area. It is accessible only from the exterior of the building. On the second floor, you'll see the relationship of the pickle and padel courts below. On the southeast corner, there'll be the storage area that I referred to from the access area below. This is going to be used for storage, additional storage for a business component that the owner has, not semi-related to this facility, but completely separate and not accessible by the facility other than from the exterior. That convenience stair or commuted stair that I talked about on the first floor brings people up to this area, which is the large viewing area. It'll be 12 feet above the courts, so they'll get a very good kind of three-sided view to all of the courts below. There'll be an additional small bar area with some storage and two additional restrooms up here.
I'm sorry, you said three-sided viewing.
Well,
maybe two. I only see two-sided viewing.
I was more thinking, I've got too many things open. I was thinking that direction, and that direction.
I assume these are considered spectator sports. And I'm wondering, do you actually accommodate enough spectators?
The Trichio and Mork, I think that's something, I mean, we've identified these types of seating areas. I think it's people waiting for courts, waiting for to access the courts. There may be some time that they'll want to stay after the event for a certain period of time.
So you're not anticipating that people will necessarily come to observe the games?
And hello, I'm Patricio, so I'm going to answer that. Yes, sure. There are spectator sports, but we're not going to have, you know, and people coming in to watch when we have a clinic and, you know, someone playing on their own. And so we're not anticipating having that sort of spectator events. And this would be similar to what you see at an indoor tennis club, mm-hmm. where there's really no one really watching from, you know, behind the court or from, you know, from the other side of the window.
Okay, thank you.
So I have a question in regards to, is this by membership only where you can access this facility, or is it a pay as you go? Can anyone access these courts?
And it will be both. And we're planning to offer a membership. So you become a member and then you reserve your courts, or if you don't want to become a member, you can still come and play. So it's going to be open to the public. It's going to be sort of a hybrid where we offer both.
Thank you.
That's actually kind of the entire program at an eyeball level.
And Darius has a question.
Oh.
Yeah. Are you thinking of having any outdoor seating?
No, and I can answer that right away. All Mr. Williams, everything that will be taking place will take place within the building. The courts are all inside. We're not proposing any outdoor courts so we wouldn't need any outdoor seating. And the outdoor areas to the south, as you know, are for parking, but there's no visibility from the outdoors in. So it's not like you would have stands or bleachers looking in. Mr. Citrano said, folks will come, they'll play, they'll take clinic lessons. Maybe they'll stay a little bit to watch friends, but it's not like there will be competitions or large gatherings at this facility.
Understood. I was just thinking more of like when people are done playing, you know, two people, if they want to have their coffee and sit outside and get some air or something.
I imagine they could certainly walk outside and hang out. Maybe some benches outside might be a nice idea. I misunderstood your question.
That's what I was thinking.
They could go down the street to the Woodward Park where they have the Norwalk Public pickleball courts.
True. that's a great suggestion. Perhaps we could incorporate maybe a couple of benches outside.
Thanks.
Will you be serving beverages? Are you serving coffee or any kind of food?
There's a bar inside, right?
Areas on the first floor and then on that mezzanine level are anticipated to have some sort of beverage service and some light food service, but there won't be a full kitchen. It's not that kind of food establishment. It's light snacks, coffee, maybe some mixed drinks, some beer. That's about what it is.
How many employees?
4 to 5, generally.
Year round?
Yes.
Thank you.
Does anyone have any other questions for Mr. Tierney? Okay, at this point, if there are none, then I'd like Ethan Chikosky to just give you an overview of his analysis and findings on the traffic. Ethan?
Hi, Ethan Chikosky. I'm with Atlantic Traffic and Design Engineering. We're located in Melville, New York, professional engineer and professional traffic operations engineer. A lot of the testimony has been covered in terms of membership and how much, you know, how many people they're expecting to use the facility. As they mentioned, it's membership and non-membership. So when we evaluated the traffic at this location, we looked at a couple different methods of trip generation. First of all, just speaking with Patricio and the operators and getting a schedule from them and understanding when the courts would be open and employees were arriving and things like that. And a typical, you know, day-to-day operation. And then at the recommendation of the TMP group, we also looked at making assumptions if every court was occupied all at once, you know, sort of worst case scenario. And then thirdly, we used Institute of Transportation Engineers, which is the industry standard for trip generation. Using land use code 492 for a health and fitness club, which is one of the more conservative uses for this type of facility. So we looked at the peak, you know, hours of traffic on the adjacent roadway. We did some traffic observations during a typical weekday when school was in session and a typical Saturday, and evaluated all the peak hours of traffic. Based on our analysis, with the addition of the site generated traffic volumes, all the movements at the nearby intersection are calculated to operate at a level of service B or better, which, you know, is an acceptable level of service for a public roadway. So, you know, based on our traffic analysis, you know, the site won't cause any significant impacts to traffic conditions. So available to answer any other questions.
Okay. Attorney Setcher, you want to move on?
Thank you, Mr. Shulman. Thank you, Mr. Chikosky. Does anyone have any questions of Mr. Chikosky or of any of us? Be happy to answer them.
Liz, I've got a question again about solar units on top of the building. According to Mr. Romano, if the issue turns out to be that the roof may not support it, is your client willing to look at the costs involved and consider whether to go forward with the solar units and reinforce the roof in order to accommodate them?
Well, thank you for the question, Mr. Shulman. And as we were as Mr. Chikosky was making his presentation, I came off screen. I've been back and forth with Mr. Fischel, who's out of the country, and he's indicated that they're meeting next week with a company with respect to the solar panels to see if it's going to be feasible. So we're actively looking at that. And if that's something that can be accommodated from a cost perspective and anything from a not only financial, but if the building can support it, we'll certainly let you know where we are. But they are meeting with folks next week.
Okay, thank you.
We have nothing else to add. Oh, excuse me, Mr. Williams.
Yeah, just one last question. Will the solar parking canopies be a part of the discussion?
The client is on right now and they can have that discussion with the company that they're talking to next week. We hadn't proposed it, but if it's something you'd like us to take a look at, I'm sure that they would be happy to investigate that and see if that's feasible.
All right, thank you.
I have nothing further to add at this point. I'd just like to reserve a couple of minutes at the end to summarize if necessary and rebut if necessary.
Of course.
But at this point, any other questions? Happy to answer them.
Okay.
Lou,
go ahead, Tammy.
I have two questions, but I don't believe they're really for Attorney Sacci, more for Steve Kleppen. Is this building currently occupied by what it shows up when you Google Earth it, dairy and asphalt? Is it in business? Or vacant?
Attorney Sacci shaking her head, no.
The building is totally vacant. Okay. There's nothing going on the side. The interior of the building is entirely vacant.
Okay, thank you. And then my second question is, in 10 years down the road, if pickleball and padel are not that popular, can this building go back to the light industrial use that it was before it became vacant?
Yes, they can put the, similar to the conversations we had revolving around the industrial zones changes, they can change the use to any conforming use within the zone that's in existence at the time that they make the change. So who knows what the changes will be 10 years from now, but yeah, anything that's on the books at that time, they can change to.
Okay, great. Thank you. And I'm all in favor of pickleball, by the way.
I was hoping to see at least some axe throwing.
You never know. Never know.
All right, Michelle, do you want to explain to the public how they can access the meeting?
Sure. So if you're on tonight from the public and would like to speak on this item, please use the raise your hand feature. It's at the bottom of your screen here. And then if you're dialed in on a phone, please press *9 to raise your hand. And we'll bring you over to speak. Not seeing any hands, so.
Okay. Any additional questions from the members of the commission? All right, if not, we'll turn it back to Attorney Sacci.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Considering the hour and that you have other items on the agenda, I just would like to mention that we believe this application complies with the standards set forth in Section 118.14.50, that's special permit, and also the standards and additional standards set forth in what was the former restricted industrial zone. Moreover, the property has no coastal resources on it, and any development or any activity is taking place in existing developed areas in the stormwater management plan. The system that's proposed will upgrade that which exists today. We will certainly work with staff to achieve compliance with parking issues that were raised and FEMA compliance, but we believe this is a great use of a vacant building, provides an activity in the neighborhood. It's going to be accessible to both members, non-members, young people and old people, and will provide Norwalk with an opportunity to experience two sports that are gaining in popularity. We hope that we've satisfied your comments, your questions and concerns, and would ask that you close the hearing tonight, and if at all possible, that you vote on this application this evening. But before we close the hearing, if there's anything else you have to ask of Mr. Romano, Mr. Tierney, or Mr. Schakowsky, or Mr. Fischel, or Ms. Atrano, we're certainly happy to answer any questions.
Apparently not.
Well, thank you. We have nothing further.
Okay, thank you. We'll close the hearing and we'll move on to action on the project. Is there a motion to approve? Darius Williams has made motion to approve. Is there a second?
I believe Tammy second.
I think we've got several seconds. JJ, I saw your hand go up first.
Tammy was first.
All right, let's pull up the there we go. Sorry about that.
Okay. We knew what you meant.
Good. Okay.
And we just added some solar language down here.
Right.
Let me know if that works for you all.
I believe Mr. Williams raised the question of solar units over the parking. Why don't we just add that, unless I've missed it? Yeah, just add it in.
And/or over parking?
I think so.
Might just need to reword that a little bit.
And didn't he use the word canopy?
Yes.
Yeah. I would put it before install. I would put it before rooftop.
Would we keep that other language and then?
Yeah, go with what you had and then put canopy piece before the rooftop. Then it's read the same.
Parking canopy was the language?
Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be a solar parking canopy.
Okay.
You might just need to change that second sentence. Because that just speaks to the rooftop.
Right. Maybe I'll just copy this. Does that make sense?
I think so.
Yes.
Yeah.
To me, it does.
Okay, we have, you want to close up by one space, the word two and the on the first line. You've got an extra space. Okay. All right, we have a resolution. We have a motion to approve the resolution. Let's go to a roll call vote.
Okay, Mr. Williams?
Wholehearted yes.
Mr. Muschak?
Yes, and I agree with Attorney Sachi. This is a great use for an empty building.
Ms. Langalis?
Yes.
Ms. Jordan Byron?
Yes.
And Mr. Shulman?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Well, thank you, everyone, for your time this evening and your attention. We certainly appreciate it. And on behalf of Mr. Mistrano, Mr. Fischel, thank you. If I don't see you soon, a happy Thanksgiving to everyone. I look forward to seeing you again. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Okay, our final public hearing, 2022-51 SP, John Watts, 4 New Canaan Avenue, wholesale distribution and retail of auto parts within existing building, as well as other site improvements. And I believe that's Attorney Blank, you represent the owner?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Adam Blank of Norwalk, lawyer for the applicant. It's a little confusing, but so it's John W. Watts was the owner who passed away. The executor of the estate is John A. Watts. So I'm here on behalf of John Watts, we'll call it, as the owner of the property. If I can share my screen, that came up, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yes. Great. So the property, this is 4 New Canaan Avenue, right here. This is the Dunkin' Donuts on the intersection of Main and 123 is right in here. You've got the Danbury line of the railroad tracks here, the Route 7 on and off ramps, and then the Wendy's over here. That's sort of your landmarks for you. That it's an existing building. It's actually two existing buildings. There's a front building and a rear. You may recall seeing them. There's a mattress store up front. There was that Cupcake Bakery was in this property that moved now to Maine. And then in the back is the shooting range. This is another angle of the property. And I'll pull up the survey real quick. We'll come back to a few of these things, but so you've got the front building here and then the rear building, that's the shooting range. We're essentially not really proposing to do much. It's really just a change of tenant. Levine's Auto, you guys probably remember seeing those yellow and blue cars sometimes around town, dropping off auto parts to garages around the city. So Levine's was acquired, and the company that acquired Levine's would like to come in at this space and continue to essentially do the same thing that Levine's did. But in fact, they'd actually like to take the entire building, the entire front building for that use. Talking with staff, we thought initially that this was just gonna be just a change of tenant, kind of quick deal. But it was determined that although Levine's had been there for years without any like violation issued, that it really wasn't a retail use. It was a wholesale distribution use, which is a special permit, which triggered us to come in front of you for a special permit. Although again, I in the grand scheme of things, this is probably not the largest of applications that's come your way. So I'm gonna give you a little bit of an overview on it, a little bit more than what I've given you so far. The company that took over for Levine's is called Parts Authority. Jake Barr, who's with Parts Authority, which would be the new tenant, not the new owner, but the new tenant. Jake is with us this evening. He'll give you just a couple of minutes on their proposed use of the property and about the company as a whole. And then Corey Chase is our traffic engineer. He'll give you, again, just 1 or 2 minutes on the traffic. And then we do have also with us Lou Garcia, who's the project architect, and Chuck Willinger, who's also an attorney. He's at Willinger & Bucci in Bridgeport. He represents the estate of John Watts in this matter. And they're not going to do formal presentations, but they can answer questions that you've got. I told you this is sort of a wholesale kind of warehouse distribution. There is a small component of retail sales, people that come in and want to buy something off the shelf. And so in the parking analysis and in the survey, all the stuff the layout from the architect, there is a small area that's designated as retail, and that would be retail, while the vast majority of the building would be wholesale distribution. This was the business two zone up until you just passed the industrial reg change, which moved this over to the I-2 zone. the application, the way your the regs work is if the application's filed prior to the effective date of a zone change, you apply the zone change that existed at the time of the filing, which so for your purposes, you're assuming this is the business two zone still. So in the business two zone, retail's a permitted use and these warehouse and distribution facilities, those are special permit uses. Let me go back to my screen for a second. The benefit to you, I guess, by virtue of us going through this process is that instead of us just switching out a tenant, I think the city's gonna get a much better site. Right now, you can see it's essentially all asphalt, almost up to the street, and there's no sidewalk for the majority of the parcel leading towards the railroad tracks here. And it's just sort of a sea of asphalt in here with no breakup of parking islands, which you see in your more recent parking layouts. This was sort of pre-existing non-conforming in that it had the parking up in the front setback. As part of the application, we are proposing some street trees, and then this area is to be landscaped, removing all of that asphalt. That was what was up on Buchanan Avenue with the sidewalk installed. The lot reconfigured and restriped so that you have sort of legally conforming spaces and parking aisles. Everything matches up with current standards. We added in a couple of loading zones. We screen the dumpster, which are all improvements on the property. We're adding a couple of ADA handicap spaces with ramps, so it will now be fully ADA compliant. And as you can imagine, and we have a traffic engineer to tell you what you probably know, but going to a sort of a warehouse or wholesale distribution of this scale is a significant reduction in the traffic that's going to be coming in and out of the site. So under your regs, you require less parking. And the traffic engineer will explain to you again briefly, but just there's going to be less traffic. This is it's not going to be a traffic generator. It meets all of your regulations and the special permit criteria. We do get a work backwards. We do have our sign-offs from health, fire, and the building department. We're waiting on a couple more. I'm sure as you normally do, you can make those conditions of approval or no permit until we've obtained them. And the green cards have gone out timely to neighbors and have been returned to your staff. With that introduction, I'd like to turn it over to Jake Barr first, unless you have questions for me. So Jake from the Tenant Parts Authority.
Good evening, everybody. First, I just want to introduce myself. My name's Jake Barr. I'm the general manager for New England for Parts Authority. Basically, Parts Authority is a business that was started in the 70s in Lake Success, New York, on Long Island. And we've grown to about over 250 locations across the country, from California down to Florida. And about 9 months ago, we purchased Levine Automotive, and we're still utilizing the Levine Automotive name, powered by Parts Authority. Now we're in Norwalk. So basically, we're pretty responsible corporate citizens. We have locations all over the country. We're not on the radar. And most of our employees are Norwalk residents. We try to hire from within the city of Norwalk. I've been to this building multiple times. And that's pretty much it.
So I have a question. So I know this property very well, and it was pointed out there is lack of sidewalk access. Will that be added?
Yes. Yeah, so we are proposing, although I mean, I will say I questioned whether it was safer with or without, but we've included in our site plan adding a sidewalk. I mean, it is going to end at the railroad track, and there's not a crossing on this side of the street of the railroad track. There is on the opposite side of the street, but yes, we're adding sidewalk.
Thank you.
Sure. And now the traffic engineer.
And then a question for the traffic engineer. Are you recommending a left turn signal at that intersection?
We're not. We're actually proposing to maintain the existing access point along New Canaan Avenue. As Mr. Blank mentioned, you know, one of the benefits of the re-tenancy of this building is that you're replacing existing retail use with a wholesale use. You're actually going to see a reduction in traffic going to and from the subject property when Parts Authority takes over the building. I also mentioned, you know, it's important to note that with the removal of that existing pervious coverage directly adjacent to the driveway, you're going to have a more standardized, typical driveway where there's actually a throat to the driveway before you get to the parking. Whereas today, it's just basically a sea of open asphalt, as Mr. Blank described. So from a site access and circulation standpoint, the site certainly could be improved with the addition of the sidewalk, the formalized parking spaces striped throughout the site. And again, with the re-tenancy, with parking it with a Parts Authority taking over the entire building, it's actually going to generate a reduction in traffic compared to the existing use.
A reduction in traffic?
Yes.
So like...
But you've taken over the you partner with Levine's, right? And now you're acquiring part of their operations. So that's my daily commute. And I see the cars turning into that lot all the time, waiting for an opening in the traffic going both ways, which is why I said, you know, are you going to, you know, recommend a left turn access point? But I mean, it's the traffic going in and out of that lot. You know, I mean, it's, of course, it's not heavy as, you know, the northbound traffic or the eastbound traffic. But nonetheless, I do see cars queuing up, waiting to make that left turn.
And that's really a function of the traffic on New Canaan Avenue. It's not necessarily a function of the traffic that's being generated by this site. So again, you know, if you put in alternate retail tenants in there, they would generate substantially more traffic than a wholesale automobile parts distributor would. Right. And really, as Mr. Blank mentioned, and as Mr. Barr mentioned, you know, this tent's really serving the existing service stations within the city of Norwalk, so that they're trips that are destined to and from the city and helping out other local businesses.
Right.
To give you a couple of points on that as well, if you drive by a lot, do you remember when the Cupcake Bakery was in there?
Yeah, I remember.
Then traffic queued a lot more often turning left in there. I mean,
it's a nightmare.
Hot retail tenant in there, you're going to get a lot more traffic than with this. And I think Jake can tell you, but I think Jake, it was something like 90% of their sales are done through their delivery drivers. So you don't have like regular customers coming in. You just have the delivery drivers leaving, and they've only have six of those guys who are going to be out most of the time, not actually there. So, you know, this taking the whole building will actually make it feel more empty because there's just not that much action.
Okay. What other tenants are leaving?
I believe the only tenant that's left in the building that's on their way out is the mattress store. The gun range, which is a separate building, remains sort of unchanged.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, thank you.
And Corey, did you have any, were you finished? Or, yeah.
I'd be happy to provide any additional testimony, Mr. Blank, but I'm done with affirmative testimony.
Sure. And if, would you guys like to hear from anybody else? Or if you have other questions, we can do it. But we were trying not to hold you up too much this evening. Okay, thank you then.
Okay. Are you ready now to open it up to the public?
We are.
Okay, thank you. Michelle, do you want to explain to the few people who are watching how they can access the meeting to speak?
Yes. So for the last time tonight, people on from the public, if you'd like to speak on this item, please use the raise your hand feature. If you're dialed in on a phone, use *9 and just state your name and address for the record if you'd like to speak. Not seeing any.
Okay. Just before you finish, Attorney Blank, I'd like to comment that 40 years ago, when my daughters were young, we bought them beanbag chairs at that store. And I'm very sorry I won't be able to do that again. Now I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you. Hopefully they will relocate elsewhere in Norwalk, but I don't have anything else to add. Thank you all for your time.
Okay, then we will close the public hearing and we'll move on to action. So we have a resolution to approve this change of use. Is there a motion?
I make the motion, Mike here.
Okay, Mike Muschak has made the motion. Darius Williams has seconded. I don't recall on this one whether we actually have a resolution. If we do, let's put it up. Okay, any questions before we proceed to a vote? I see a lot of people shaking their heads. Let's do a roll call.
Sorry, I was hitting the wrong button every time. Okay, Mr. Williams.
Yes.
Ms. Jordan Byron.
Yes.
Ms. Langalis.
Yes.
Mr. Muschak.
Yes, and I applaud the parking lot changes. It's just going to be a lot more attractive and safer.
And Mr. Shulman.
Yes.
Unanimous.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a great night.
All right, it's only 8:27. We have a one more substantive piece of business.
Can we take a break?
It's only 8:27. Let's take a break at 9 if we run that late. If that's okay.
I concur.
Okay.
I have faith we can power through.
2022.
That's the person who already had his dinner.
Well, we wouldn't take a break that would be long enough for that. 2022-52R, Planning and Zoning Commission, Zoning Regulations, Amendments to Article 100, Supplementary Regulations for Business and Industrial Zones to permit various cannabis uses with associated standards and requirements. This is a continuing review and conversation. Steve, why don't I let you kick it off?
Sure. Would you like me to pull up the draft? I don't have any specific presentation for you.
That's okay.
As you remember, we had this up last meeting for discussion, where we just basically talked about kind of the idea, where how it generated, legislation behind it. And what we've initially proposed for recommendations, the commission decided to move this toward public hearing with the idea we had to do several referrals, and with the earliest that this would pop up would probably be at your December 8th hearing. Keeping in mind, the rules are always subject to change based on input for obviously from the commission and from the public that you get at that time. But I can pull up what we have.
I think it doesn't hurt to go through it again.
Sure. Give me just a sec.
Are we going to be having a public comment on this, Lou?
We'll be holding a public hearing.
Oh, but not this evening.
No, not this evening.
Okay, thank you.
Right. Hey, Michelle, can you pull, my computer's just, every time I click on the link to that, it's jumping elsewhere. I don't know why.
Sure, which item or which link?
It's, if you go on, I'll try one more time. See if it, I'll try it a different way. All right, I got it now.
Okay.
All right. So I'll give a brief kind of overview, and I'm assuming you'd like me to blow that up a little, correct?
If you could.
I'll try. Just have to move you guys off my box to blow it up. Okay, so the state of Connecticut is part of the new cannabis regulations define a lot of different things, and they centered around, and obviously the most controversial is the retail sales of cannabis itself. So they defined what that is, which is a cannabis dispensary facility, which would be the medical end of it, the cannabis retailer being just straight sales of marijuana products. And then there's a hybrid retailer, which could do the medical and the retail cannabis. There are several definitions related to cultivators and micro cultivators, which are basically growing facilities. And there are also definitions related to transportation and packaging. There are also a whole other slew of definitions within the statute, but not all of them have zoning implications. So obviously anything with the retail sales is going to be a hot topic and where that can be located and the impacts around it. The growers are also zoning related because the recommendation is to consider them like a manufacturing use because there's no consumption or sales allowed on those premises. And you also could technically deal with somebody that was a packager or a transporter because there could be commercial vehicles involved and or storage of the product. So we have a chart here that shows the proposed zones and where those uses could be located and the types of permitting involved to locate one of those facilities. The obviously, as I mentioned, the hot topic issue would be the retail sales of it. So that is a special permit use allowed really only what we're proposing in the B1 and B2 zone. And that basically, I can show you a map in a second, but that would center along the Route 1 corridor and Main Avenue. Focusing on that, with that, all these different uses, whether they're the growers or the retail, there's several restrictions and conditions we've placed around them. Some of these we've already discussed that we had a little bit of pushback from the public. And one of those is item number 8 on there, which we didn't allow drive-through facilities, but in speaking with a couple of users, or I should say potential applicants, they indicated that a lot of the sales that are generated from the retail cannabis are kind of ordered online for pickup. So to allow them with the drive-through capacity actually moves the traffic through the site quicker, lessens the parking load, and moves the traffic through just better in general. So that would be something that, you know, you might want to consider removing from the initial draft. There's all sorts of licensing requirements that go along with this that they have to adhere to. In addition, these specific users have to provide security plans that need to get reviewed and approved by the Norwalk Police Department. So that, you know, the idea being some of these could be, you know, based on the value of the product that they're storing on site, could be potential targets, and you don't want that to be ignored or just be looked at too lightly. So that will be why we would recommend that the police department be involved on the initial review, make sure that, you know, that there's no problems down the road. As I mentioned, the cultivators, we will recommend to treat as we would any other manufacturing. There are some additional caveats that we want to make sure, you know, that obviously we don't want any odors associated with this leaving the facility. So they would have to, you know, make sure they have a pretty hefty HVAC protocol in place. And that would be something that we would review and the commission would review as part of any special permit application. For the retailers, which again is going to garner the most interest and scrutiny, we are recommending that there be no more than three allowed at this point in time. That three was initially generated from the first statutory language that was passed. And they conveniently changed it right after everybody started moving on these changes. And that cap was that there could be one retail establishment for every 25,000 people. So since Norwalk is under 100,000, but over 75, you could have three. So that's where the three came from. There's a lot of discussion in from my counterparts elsewhere about whether that cap would actually hold up to legal muster, since that's generally not something you could do within a zoning regulation. But we're confident we can provide backup. And on the flip side, the way the other restrictions that you see here below in terms of where these facilities can be located with separation distances to like facilities, that we think at the high end of, you know, even if our cap was proven to be illegal, that at the high end, we wouldn't get any more than five. I think it would actually be less than that, because I believe there are going to be many property owners who choose not to allow these on their properties, whether A, it's because of the fact that A, it's not a federally allowed use, and B, there are certain conditions within their tenancy already that where they would not be allowed to have that in proximity to some of their other tenants on site based on those agreements. And, you know, certain users might not want to have those types of tenants in proximity to their stores. So number eight under this retail provision indicates the separation distances that are under consideration at this time. And again, these can be adjusted and tweaked at any time going forward, you know, based on what we see, testimony we receive, et cetera. So that gives you a sense of that. And I can show you a map of what we've put together to date based on these criteria, how we've applied it, and what we think is feasible.
Steve, if instead of indicating the number of shops that may be open to legal challenge, why not deal, if we think three as a commission, for example, is the right number, why not simply establish a map with distances that would only permit three of these stores to be established, and avoid the possible jeopardy of a legal challenge to a number, the number being defined not by an actual number, but by a distance between these shops?
I can work with Amelia in our office on that aspect and see what's feasible and what's not feasible. Mm-hmm. I think the broader point is that there may be, and I'm positive because I spoke to many of them, there will be property owners that don't allow that. So you might end up, based on those increased separation distances and the fact that certain property owners aren't going to allow that, you may zone them right out of existence anyway. So I think that's something to be cognizant of when we're thinking about this.
Well, how does that zone them out of business? If we say on Connecticut Avenue and a portion of Route 7, you can have one, and on Westport Avenue and the other portion of Route 7, you can have one. It covers the entire area where they're permitted, but it limits in that example the number to just two. I mean, if that in and of itself isn't going to stop a company that wants to come in and establish a shop from trying to do that. It's no different from simply stating we only want two in Norwalk.
Yeah, well, I'll definitely take a look. Maybe the map might help answer that a little bit as well. So the pink parcels, I guess they're sort of pink parcels. Those are parcels that there was two other criteria we established for eligible lots. They had to be at least a half acre in size and at least 100 feet wide. And the reason behind that was more of a traffic and parking concern, that if you had a smaller parcel that maybe was a single user, perhaps that might lead to less availability of parking or less ability to share parking amongst other users. Again, those numbers can be modified or removed from the analysis if you don't think that's appropriate. Whereas the kind of yellow parcels are also within the zones that permit it, they also meet the other separation requirements, but they aren't half an acre and 100 feet wide. So what we did with this exercise here is we mapped out where we think that we could fit these in. So we took kind of like starting at the farthest points of the eligible parcels and tried to see how many we could fit. And that's where we came up with the five that potentially could fit. Now, that's five just based on these criteria, and it doesn't factor into will that property owner even want that on their site. So that's, like I said, that's probably another significant limiting factor. But we can definitely relook at some different ways to try to shoehorn that in a little bit more or restrict it without having the cap. We can definitely explore that.
I think that five sites is oversaturation.
Right, so five is not what we're proposing.
I was under the impression that we had identified three that fit that whole metrics of being, you know, sensitive, being far away from schools and churches and, you know, along pathways for transportation in and out, adequate parking and you know, not in areas, like you said, where their neighbors would oppose. I thought there was three that was definitely identified. So why are we talking about five?
So we're not proposing five. What we're keeping with the regulations still have a maximum of three that's permitted.
Right.
But there is a concern, and it's possible, and I don't think there's no test case on it yet. But if somebody were to, so say the city approved three establishments, mm-hmm. and then you had somebody else apply, and he's saying your cap is illegal, you can't put a cap on. They would take the city to court. There would be litigation on that cap, whether that's a legal cap or not. If that person won the case, then they would be allowed to put that fourth establishment in, provided they could find a location that met all those other criteria. So what we're saying is, based on our analysis, if we lost that court case, the most we think you would see of the eligible sites is 5. Not we're not proposing 5, but we think if we lost a court case on that, you could see 2 more.
Okay.
But JJ, the point I was making is, if these circles are larger, you might be able to limit the number of units to the 3 that the city wants, for example.
Right.
Without facing the possible jeopardy of establishing a number.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yes, expand the territory. I'm in favor of that.
We can run any number of different scenarios based on those buffers. I know we did at one time. So the initial, I think we had 1,000 feet from the sensitive sites as well as from the schools and the youth serving. So it was 1,000 across the board.
Right.
But I think it shrunk down the available sites down to a really small number. But we could run any scenario you think of in terms of possibilities and show you all those maps easily enough.
Hmm.
Are we going to have another meeting before we go to public hearing on this?
We haven't. The only other meeting scheduled is on November 29th. I don't know if there's time to get into it that night. We can certainly add it to the agenda and see where we stand.
Ooh, yeah, I can't imagine there's going to be time for that.
At the same time, even if you do hold the hearing December 8th, you're not obligated to take action that night. You can hold the item open. You can continue the hearing. This is basically a city-driven initiative. So it's not like you're bound to the applicant's time constraints.
What I'm trying to get at is, I'd like to see some of these alternate analyses that you and the staff will put together before we go into the public hearing.
Yeah, we can get you those. I'll double check Amelia's availability to work on this, but we can, within the next, possibly by net before Thanksgiving, to give you something to look at.
Okay, that'd be great.
All right, one question, Steve. Did the city determine the 500 feet from sensitive sites, 1,000 feet from school, or was that a state suggested criteria?
I have to go back and look, because there was a bunch of back and forth, because I think the sensitive sites list was based on what we were seeing elsewhere, but then the city amended it to add other items that they felt were appropriate as well. So it was based on, I don't think the statute might have referenced schools, if I recall correctly, but the tricky thing is the statute changed like twice since we first started looking at it. So I'd have to go back and look, but okay. We based it on, what we saw elsewhere would have been the guiding principle on that.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Steve, is there anything else we need to discuss on this now?
I don't believe so.
Okay. Then let's continue with agenda. Next item, we're down sort of to the short strokes. Approval of minutes of November 3rd. Can I have a motion to approve the minutes? All right. Tammy has moved. Darius has seconded. All those in favor, show of hands.
I'm abstaining because I wasn't here.
Okay, so it's 4-1 minutes are approved. Do we have to have separate minutes for the special meeting?
Is that a question for Diana?
No, it's a question for Steve.
I'm sorry, can you say that again, please?
Yeah, I was asking whether we needed to have two votes, one on the regular meeting
and
one
on the for the 6 p.m. and the 7 p.m.? Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so can I have a motion on the special meeting? That is the 6 p.m. meeting on November 3rd. And Darius' hand goes up quickly. Tammy seconds. And
I offer a special abstention.
Okay, Mike has a special abstention. Everybody else approves. All right, comments of the director. Steve?
So I just hit sent on an email to you guys with the zoning regulations link and the bylaws. You have both of those now. Just I ask you don't share the zoning regulations with anybody pending the meeting on the 29th, which is where the consultant will walk you through the regulations. What we're thinking is we're going to do a similar exercise, Brian and I, at your meeting on December 8th, where we'll walk you through the zoning map, and then we'll release that out to the public. So we're still working through a couple sensitive areas. We want to make sure there's not going to be any major issues and concerns that pop up with those areas. So we'll finalize that map and have it out around that time as well. So that's the plan. And then we'll discuss at a later date where we go with commission meetings to go over topics once you've had a little time to really look at it and be thoroughly confused. We'll start that process.
Okay. Anything else? That it?
That's it.
Okay. I have something I just wanted to bring up. It would have been better had we actually had a conversation about 810 Pulaski rather than them withdrawing. They were permitted to build 15 housing units. They built 16. And they were coming to us tonight for approval to build the 16. Given that ZBA did a trade-off with them, they would allow the additional unit in exchange for them making two of their units below market rate. Not a bad trade-off. However, they've been renting this additional apartment for quite some time. And we don't have a good tool to discourage that kind of behavior. What I was talking to Steve is the possibility of a strong fine. You know, you do something like that illegal and you want to beg our pardon for your bad behavior, you know, maybe you have to pay $5,000 or $10,000, and it's not quite that simple. but I think we ought to start a conversation about what we realistically can do, because this isn't a new problem. It's happened before. if we can't do anything more than slapping them on the wrist, we're not really discouraging it from occurring again. So I just wanted to get people thinking about that. And we'll put it on an agenda on an evening when we don't have a heavy agenda of other items. But it is something that bothers me.
Lou, was it mentioned in their application that they originally applied? I mean, I thought I read the application pretty carefully. And what you just said in the beginning was that they originally applied for 15 and built 16. That, I don't think it was stated that way.
Stated in the note. I could be wrong, but I thought that was in the notes from the staff. Am I wrong?
They just wanted to add that additional apartment because it was never there to begin with. But you're saying it's been there all along.
Yes.
Did anybody else pick that up, or did I just miss that?
Nope, we read it the same way.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Perhaps like a fine could be a portion of the revenue that was made on something like that.
The problem, as I understand it, is we don't necessarily have the authority to do something like that, even though it makes good sense.
Well, doesn't the building department, like if they're illegally renting something, doesn't the building department have the authority to fine them?
I think it would fall under the ordinance committee.
Right, and that in the building department?
Yeah, I think if it's a zoning violation, we would handle it. Statutorily, we're limited to our, you know, if we fine them, it's $150 a day fine.
Right.
So if someone's collecting a lot of rent, it's, you know, that's, you know, the rent might far exceed what we could do on a daily basis. The zoning enforcement is meant to gain compliance, not to collect fees. I mean, that's just the way right. the courts have. So, you know, we can slap on a very large fine. Once in a while, we do take someone to court over issues that it's not a quick process either, regardless of what the scenario is that we're, whether it's an illegal apartment or legal construction or whatever, it's never a quick process. And even when we go through our citation enforcement process, the enforcement, the citation officer, he tries to just get compliance. So we have the hammer, which could be the bigger fine. And when it gets up to, you know, we have a bunch of them that are well over like $10,000, but we usually end up having to put a lien on the property. So if and when they go to sell, you know, the city will collect funds, but it doesn't always get quick compliance. So we can do something, you know, what's been done, I've seen done in the fee schedule, you know, is like work without permits, but I don't think you can do a $10,000 work without permit
right.
fee. Something we'll explore with the law department. I think there's going to be a much smaller number than what you'll probably want to really make a difference.
Steve, can we have someone on the staff make, I don't know, maybe a dozen phone calls to some of the other larger cities in the state and find out how, if at all, they deal with these issues?
Yeah, that's a quick, I can query, there's a planner's listserv that they all subscribe to. That's easy to get answers.
Okay, good.
I'd like to add one thing. I was involved in the blight ordinance, advocating for it, walking common council members around our neighborhood, et cetera, about 12 years ago. And it took a few years to get it passed, but we ended up adopting language similar to Stamford. And we've collected hundreds of thousands of dollars through that and actually forced a lot of blighted properties to be fixed up. And then the money theoretically was used for people who were truly, you know, either elderly or disabled or low income that had, you know, verifiable reason why they couldn't fix up their property to a standard, which is all spelled out in the ordinance, you know, basically fixing peeling paint, collapsing porches, broken windows, you know, it was very specific. But the fines were substantial. I mean, it was $100 a day, but that adds up quickly. And a lot of people have had to pay it when they went to sell their property. There were liens on the property. It's been successful. I think that's just an example I'm throwing out there that where a fine framework has worked. I'm not sure in recent years if it's really as successful as it was 8 or 10 years ago, but it was remarkable how it was able to clean up a lot of chronically blighted properties that were bringing down property values, you know, of surrounding neighbors.
And, you know, and while Steve is right about wanting to have compliance, we also want to discourage the behavior. And fines will do that, or may do that, in addition to getting compliance. You want to set an example for other people who may think of behaving badly as well. and discourage them from doing it.
I do the blight statutory language is better than the zoning statutory language around the enforcement compliance.
And I think that's administered by the building department. I think the building inspector is the blight inspector. I think we couldn't hire a blight inspector. Remember that discussion? So we just gave the title to the building inspector.
I think there are blight officers now. I think they're trying to get another one in the budget.
Oh, wow. See how things have changed. Well, anyway. So, all right, I think.
Wait, we've got to conclude the meeting in 1 minute. Otherwise, we have to take a break. So the first issue is, are there any other commission members who want to bring anything to our attention?
Excuse me while I adjust my catheter. Sorry.
okay. Then I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion.
Okay, Darius moves, JJ seconds, and I think everybody is in agreement. Enjoy your Thanksgiving, your time with your families. Look forward to seeing you all on the 29th.
Okay.
Have a good night.
Good night.
Night.
Bye.